All right. Welcome, everyone. We are so excited to have you here today for the Realtor Builder Committee event. The topic today is understanding the Realtor Builder relationship in new home construction, which I think is a really wonderful topic for all of you realtors out there who are looking to partner with more builders. Today, we have two amazing presenters. We have Michelle Lynch, and she's with Classic Cottages. She's a sales manager over there. And we also have Scott Murray, who is the president of Focal Point Homes. So we're very thrilled to have them here, and I'm going to let them chime in a little bit more with their introduction, and we'll get right into it.
Thanks, Helen. So I'm Michelle Lynch. I'm the sales manager, and I am a traditional realtor, was a traditional realtor, I should say, like all of you. I sold resale since 2012. Several homes, both resale and new construction with track builders, and then also with custom builders as well. And about 2 years ago, almost three now, Classic Cottages called and asked me to come and join their team. So I really enjoyed this aspect of it. It's been kind of in my blood for quite a while. So I'm excited to share some information with you and hopefully partner with you guys in the future.
Hey, thanks, Michelle. And I'm Scott Murray. I live in McLean with my wife and my five children. I grew up in Georgia and until I graduated from high school. And then I later went to Brigham Young University, where I majored in construction management. And then after that to Harvard, where I got an MBA at business school there. I spent 12 years with national home builders, working about seven different states. And doing things like land acquisition, and then ultimately 4 years as a division president for one of them over a few states. And then 10 years ago, I started Focal Point Homes. And so Focal Point is an infill builder. So we basically build about 30 homes a year, mostly in and near McLean right now, build about 30 a year. But they're all in infill lots. So that means that we're constantly, it's a lot where we're tearing down an existing home to build a new one. So that's a little bit about me. And then we have, lined up today, Michelle and I are going to talk a little bit about a few different topics that we thought might be of interest to realtors. And those are going to be the typical time frame for permitting and building a new home. When can a contract to buy a new home from a custom builder be entered into? And does timing affect a buyer's ability to choose finishes? The pros and cons of stock, custom, or customizable plans. What to watch out for when looking for lots to build on. The different ways new construction can be financed, the potential tax benefits of donating the materials from a home slated for demolition, and finally, how involved do realtors need to be in the process from contract writing on to completion. And so we'll go ahead and start off. And actually, Michelle's going to talk about the first three topics there, and then I'll speak about three, and then Michelle will speak about one more when I'm finished.
Great. Thanks, Scott. So we'll start with the first one, like Scott said. So that's the typical time frame from permitting to the completed build of a home. And permitting, depending upon the county that we're building in, we predominantly build in Fairfax County and Arlington County, and we're doing some stuff in the city of Alexandria. It typically takes between 2.5 months to 3 months, sometimes 4 months, depending upon the specific situation. So that is county specific, depending upon time frame. And then for us, we usually say like a 6 month build time. So you're looking at, once permits are received, we're going to do the demolition of the existing house and then start the build. So it's about a 6 month time frame. During that 3 month permit process, if we have a buyer lined up, so if your buyers join prior to, or maybe they have a lot that they're interested in building on, we would be designing the home in terms of the finishes inside of the home. So tile, cabinets, etc. And the reason we do that early is because we want to make sure that the build stays on track. So if cabinets have a longer lead time, etc., doing that all in the permit phase of building or of the building process, it just makes it a lot easier and a smoother 6 month process to completion. What I typically tell people, so maybe they're building on their lot, maybe they, are trying to plan for when they're to when to put their current house on the market, I usually say it's a 10-month time frame. So, you know, weather always comes into play and other things might come into play. Right now with COVID, we're having issues with some supply chain stuff. So I usually say 10 months is a really good time frame to tell them, and then you can plan to maybe list their current home in that, you know, closer to that end of the 10-month time frame. Okay, moving on. So when can you enter a contract to buy a new home? So in that case, you can enter into a contract at any point in time. So we're happy to do it when we have a lot. We love to do it before we have a lot and pre-sell. That's called a pre-sale. And let's say we have the lot, we're ready to go, and we're going to get them into the contract. Now, that's a builder contract that we're going to be doing. And Scott will talk a little bit later about the different ways to finance, because in our case, there's two different contracts that we would use in that regard. But there's, you know, two different ways to do that. But contract-wise, you can do it at any point in time. And then depending upon when the house is completed, like let's say it's a completed spec house, as we call them, so we didn't have a buyer in hand, that would be a typical NVAR contract during that time frame. The key is when you are getting your clients into the contract and what point in construction we are, because then that's going to limit the amount of selections that your buyer would have. So typically, you know, when we're further along in the process, tile's probably already in. We're probably not going to rip out tile without a, you know, increased cost to your client. Cabinets are usually already ordered. So, you know, we're happy to share that information and, you know, work with the buyers. You know, maybe it's a hardware change or a stain of a floor color or paint or something like that. But when it's a lot further along, there are limited selections that your buyer would be able to make in that regard. And then moving on, the pros and cons of stock, custom, and customizable plans. So Classic Cottages is a design build firm. So we have architects and designers on staff, slightly different than maybe like a track builder who has plans that they use and really don't like to stray from. So with us, it's a lot easier to move a wall, you know, maybe change window sizes, add a third bay to a garage, whatever it might be to fit on that lot. So stock product, or we call it off the rack here, a floor plan, is a set price. So we've built it before, we know what it is, we're not going to allow very many changes or anything like that. You really can't move walls easily, so to speak. I mean, obviously you could, but it costs money. But that would be like a stock plan. Like, this is off the shelf, we know what the cost is going to be, super easy, really not customizable. Then we have a custom plan. So the custom plan would be start from scratch. So you get a white piece of paper and you're working with the architect to build what it is that you're looking for that would work, or your buyers are looking for that would work for their families. And super easy to make changes. We're making the changes for the buyer and for their families. The con of that is timing and price, right? So you're looking at between 30 and 45 days to just design a plan with the architect. And then from there, you're going to be designing, or you're going to be putting it through permits, engineering, et cetera. So there is a longer lead time than taking something that's right off of the shelf. And then obviously price increase. So working with the architect is going to cost money. And then on top of that, you're also going to have, you know, we're going to have to price it out in terms of what does that look like, how much square footage. And it's, if it's not a project that we've built before, you know, that might take a little bit more time. And then finally, customizable, which I would probably put in the same category as stock. A customizable plan we typically see with like a track builder or somebody who, you know, here's this option that you can do. So you have limited changes per the plan. So let's say we have, you know, a house and you want to add a sunroom. You have the optional sunroom. And you'll see this with some of the track builders. They'll have their plan set and, you know, here's an extra, if you want the sitting room, if you want the sunroom, if you want to add a wet bar in the basement, all these different things that you can add into it as being customizable. And that's kind of limited changes. They're not really excited about moving walls, structural walls, or stuff like that. And you can choose from that regard. But really outside of those customizable plans that are kind of stock off the market, off the shelf, but have these different things that you can do. You're not really going to move walls and really make it a custom home. So that that would be the pros and cons of that. We like to do, and I would say at Classic Cottages, we probably do about 60-40 right now. So 40% of design build, which is basically starting from scratch. And then 60% would be one of our projects or one of our floor plans that are off the rack. And we might move some walls around or customize it to fit the lot or fit the family. Scott, you want to take over?
All right. Hey, so thanks, Michelle. So what Classic Cottage does is pretty similar to what Focal Point does, and that most of our stuff is on infill properties. There aren't a lot of lots, you know, vacant lots around Darlington or McLean, you know, a lot of these kind of close-in areas. And so typically what we're doing is we're buying a lot and we're tearing a home down to build a new one. And so a lot of times customers come to us with a lot, and they, you know, they want us to build on it. It might be a home that they've already been living in. It might be a lot that they recently purchased. Ideally, it's a lot that they're looking at, and they want a little bit of guidance. And realtors are also often helping them try to find lots. It's probably not possible for me in the next few minutes to teach you everything that you need to know about that, but let me at least, highlight some of the things to be thinking about, and then how you can go about, making sure you're being careful enough for your clients. And so a few things you might want to look out for, or a handful of things, are, some simple things like, is water available to the site? Is gas available to the site? Is a sewer available? If it's not, if sewer is not there, for example, can it, will the lot accommodate a septic field? Is it a buildable lot? Same thing with water. Would you need to get a well if public water is not available? And if so, is there a good supply of water underground? You'll need to know about setbacks, zoning. How big of a house could you put on there? What kind of things can you do there, especially if your client has some specific a specific plan in mind or some specific ideas for the lot? You might want to know their covenants in the land records that are more restrictive than zoning code. We often find lots of people come to us and they've maybe worked with a realtor or even on their own. They bought a lot. They thought they checked all their boxes, and then they didn't realize that in the land records, the original developer put more restrictive covenants on the property because he wanted the setbacks to be more. He wanted there to be just restrictions on how big of a garage you can build or how many levels you can build. So it's good to check those things in the land records. What about easements? Are there easements on the property for, for drainage or for landscaping or for sewer lines? Because if there's an easement on the lot, especially if it runs right through the middle of the lot, that's going to greatly complicate, building a house. So you want to know about those. What about lot coverage requirements? Different municipalities have different requirements as far as what's allowed to build. A same size lot in the town of Vienna as in Fairfax County, we can't build the same thing. It actually has to be a little smaller in the town of Vienna because they have some different requirements. Some big things to be concerned about are soils. Are soils suitable for construction? Are they wet? Are they they have other problems. You need to dynamite rock out, something like that. So those are things you want to think about a little bit. Are there floodplains on the property? And not just are there floodplains, but how far away is the floodplain? In Fairfax County, for example, your elevation of your lowest floor. So for example, your basement, if you had a basement, needs to be 18 inches above the level of the floodplain. And it also needs to be, now I'm blanking out, it's either 10 or 15 feet away from it as well. So someone might look at a lot and say, the floodplain's back here, it's not going to cause a problem for us. But it might still, because in Fairfax County, for example, they have this additional kind of both height and length away from the floodplain requirements. You want to look, does it have a resource protection area? That's, for Chesapeake Bay, that's basically protecting water. You have to be a certain distance away from, from water sources and even wetlands, even if they're seasonal. And so you have to be careful about that. There's a lot of rules as to what you can do within a resource protection area and what you can't. And you'll probably need an expert to help out with that eventually if you determine that there is one. Is there high groundwater? We'll always have a soils engineer go out there and do a boring during, you know, right after we've gone into contract, just to make sure that we've had before where they bored down and hit water 2 feet underground. And if that happens, it's going to be pretty hard to build a basement if you're kind of building it inside a swimming pool. So you want to check groundwater, topography, you know, how it might affect construction expense. And a lot of folks will say, hey, you know, it's a great flat lot. It's a perfect flat lot. If you tell a civil engineer that you've got a flat lot, that's the worst case for a civil engineer, because he says, well, how are we going to get the water off of the lot and away from the house? In addition, if it's flat, you're going to have to dig a lot more for a basement. It's going to be more to carry off dirt, those kind of things. So you'll want to think a little bit about topography. That's going to affect as well drainage. You know, you might want to look and say, hey, is this at the bottom of the hill? Is the water from the 20 lots nearby, is it all draining onto this lot? Or vice versa, is this high? And if we build a new house, is it going to upset neighbors? And, you know, really thinking about drainage and how you can keep water away from the house and, you know, away from neighbors as well, especially when it comes to basements. Are there HOA requirements? A lot of times there might be an architectural review committee that's a little more stringent. You need to know about those things before buying a property, because you can get a client of yours could get pretty surprised if they bought a lot thinking they can build one thing and then find out they can't. Some simple ways now, that sounds like a long list of things, but there are a few things you can think about when you're doing this. One, is there other new construction nearby? Or have other new homes been built on the street? If they have, that could be a sign that, one, you know, that it can be done. Someone's done it, so obviously it can be done. If the house you're thinking about building is maybe similar, so that's at least gives you an initial idea that maybe it can be done. And it also can let you know what neighbors think about it. You know, are neighbors used to new construction? Do they understand, you know, the noise and so on? Because if you're the first house that's being built new on the street, some neighbors, it's going to be some, maybe some concerned neighbors who don't like all the construction vehicles parked in the street and so on, or the noise, and they might hear from hammering and sawing and so on. So those are a couple of things you can look for. So where are sources that you can find the answers to some of these questions? Now, eventually, if you're moving forward, you'll need a soils engineer, a civil engineer, and an arborist to look at all these different things and make sure you're checking all the boxes as far as the requirements go. But before you start spending money on that, some easy things to do are you can go to the property record site for the county. You can figure out what size it is. Maybe you can figure out what size the lot is, what the zoning requirements are. Fairfax County has a great resource called a digital map viewer. And you can just type into Google, you know, Fairfax County digital map viewer. And that gives you lots of different maps. It'll tell you what kind of soils are on each lot. It'll tell you where the RPA is, where the floodplains are, and so on. And so that's, you know, that's super helpful. It has zoning on there as well. And then the other thing that I would recommend is prior to, officially buying a lot, I'd recommend that you maybe get a builder involved early. Having a builder who can kind of look at it a little bit and just say, hey, these are things you might want to, you might want to be concerned about. And they can also give you an idea of what it might cost to develop that particular lot, because it might vary anywhere from $80,000 to, $300,000, depending on the conditions of the lot. You know, you need a septic field or you don't. Are there problems with soils? You know, different things like that. And so you'll want to be careful about that. So those are just a handful of things to think about when looking for lots to build on. But you want to be careful about that. Next is we talked about the different ways new construction can be financed. And so, there's a few different ways that can be done. There's one, just simple way that a client of yours could just buy a speculative home that a new home builder has built. They already own them. I mean, the builder owns the property, is building the house, they financed it. And then your client would just be buying it at the end, just like a regular, resale home, which is a regular mortgage, nothing special required. But throughout that process, as Michelle said, they can still customize the home by putting up a deposit, and they can customize the home through that process. The next thing a client can do is they can buy the lot themselves, and they can get an acquisition and development loan, or if they already own the property and it's a home that they're tearing down, they can get financing for that as well. Typically, the bank is going to require about 20, if you're acquiring a lot, typically they're going to want your client to have to put down about 20 to 30% of the acquisition price. So just to make the math simple, if it were $1 million lot, which is not unusual here in this area, they would be expected to put maybe $200,000 to $300,000 on the lot purchase. then the bank is typically going to finance construction. And I would say a large percentage of them will finance construction at 100% at that point. It won't require any more money from the, from your client. Typically they're only paying interest payments during all of construction and not principal. So it's just interest. And they're only paying interest on the amount of the loan that's outstanding. So if they're buying a lot, when they have that initial acquisition, they use part of the loan for the acquisition. And then as the builder builds, he will submit draws, or he or she will submit draws and request more funds. So if 20% of the house has been done, they'll request 20% of payment. And then at that point, the bank would issue that, and then the client would begin paying interest on those additional funds as well. So those are some things that would happen with, getting the, as far as some different ways, things can be financed. And then the third way is just a hybrid situation where the client identifies the lot. They talk to the builder. The builder agrees to buy the lot for the client. And then just a regular loan is used at the end for that. And so often, not all builders, but at least a small percentage of builders, we are willing to do this. And I believe the class of cottages as well is willing to buy a lot for a customer. And we might require a slightly bigger deposit in that case because we're taking on more risk for them. But that's an option as well. And that's an option that people sometimes want when they have a house to sell. They can't get financing to buy a lot until they've sold their other house. Or sometimes they're worried about just getting a lot. Maybe it's kind of a seller's market, and it's easier to have a builder do it because they don't have to have a 30 or 45 day financing contingency or appraisal contingency and those kind of things. And sometimes sellers are a little more comfortable with selling directly to a builder who may not have to have so many contingencies or perhaps any contingencies at all. The final topic I was going to talk about is the potential tax benefits of donating the materials from a home slated for demolition. So as an alternative to just demolishing the home, the building and, that's already the existing one and taking it to the dump or maybe recycling part of the materials, you can actually donate, your clients could donate the house to a nonprofit. And there are several different, nonprofits in the area that will accept a home donation. And what that means is they'll come out and they'll actually take the home apart, kind of piece by piece, pull the nails out of each stud. They'll take the windows, they'll take the toilet seat, they'll take, the countertops and the sinks and faucets and so on. And through that process, you will get an appraisal of the value of the materials. When I say you, I'm talking about the client, but a value of the materials that can be donated. A typical appraisal in this area might come up at, say, like $180,000 as the value of the materials. At that point, so a couple things are going to happen. One, you can feel good about yourself for having gotten a, recycled the materials. Many of them will be reused. Also, there are people who now have jobs that are going to be paid to disassemble the house. And then, important to lots of folks is there's also a very significant tax benefit for this, potentially. So, for example, if the materials are valued at, $175,000, for example, according to the appraiser, then if you were someone who was paying the highest, federal tax rate of 37% currently, you would end up having a charitable contribution of $175,000. It would reduce your taxable income by that amount. And then you would end up saving in taxes about $65,000. Now there's more to it than that. I'm kind of oversimplifying, but there's potentially, some very significant savings in addition to feeling good about recycling and giving jobs to others and things getting reused. Also there are some significant tax savings. This typically does add about 2 to 3 weeks to the process. Generally on the front end, while we're still waiting for permits, they can get in the house and maybe do some stuff, disassemble some things inside for about 2 or 3 weeks. That doesn't hold anything up because you're still waiting for a permit. But once you get a demolition permit, it still takes them about 2 weeks or so to take the rest of the house down. And so it does take a little bit longer. But, there are a lot of benefits for that, for that 2 weeks lost as well. People worth noting is people used to do something similar to this with letting the fire department come in and kind of do some training exercises, practice burning the house down. Same thing with the police department coming through and kind of practicing, home raids or things like that, shooting things up, I guess. So the IRS used to allow that. The IRS specifically does not, and they still allow you to do that. I mean, that's a nice, a nice charitable thing to do. But they no longer let people allow that to be a charitable contribution for purposes of adjusting their taxable income. And then the final, note that I would say is, in regards to all this, in order for this to happen, the client needs to own the lot. So the builder can't own the lot for them in order for the client to get that tax benefit. The client needs to own the lot, purchased it. And then finally, I would say I'm not an expert on taxes or so on. And so if you'd want to consult an accountant, to make sure that they feel comfortable with this. So that being said, I think we'll turn it back over to Michelle for our last topic, which was just how involved your realtors need to be in the process.
Perfect. That's a great disclaimer, Scott. We're not tax experts, right? So how involved do you need to be in the process? Well, first, I would say you know your clients the best. You know your buyers, sellers, et cetera, the best. So if you get as much information from them up front, you know, what's important to them? Is it important that they have an attached garage? Is it important that all their bedrooms have bathrooms? What's the most important thing? Do they need yard space? Do they need to be in a specific school district? All of those things you know the best. So when you're reaching out to builders to do an introduction, explain that to us and any builder that you're reaching out to, because then that helps us prepare for a meeting that we're going to have with you and your clients. So, you know, wants and needs, if you have that list up front, you know they absolutely need to have, you know, a half an acre of land. They absolutely need to be in a specific school zone. Let us know that, and then we can kind of narrow down what is available if we know of anything, but then also just preparing for the meeting. And then also important to know, right? So as Scott talked about financing, there's lots of different ways to finance. So if you can start, you know a little bit about finances to know whether or not they can do the lot purchase and do a construction finance, or if they need us to carry it. Knowing that up front is actually really helpful as well. And we can kind of take them down the different ways. In terms of contract, depending upon the time that you get in with the builder in construction, it's either going to be a builder contract that we have, and we will write that. You obviously will be able to see it, but you'll write that and then get it to your clients to sign. If it's a spec house, so if it's a house we've already done and the house is completed, there's not really anything left to do, it might be on the MLS, might not, we're kind of finishing it up, then you would just use the standard NBAR contract for that sales contract. And then typically when we're talking about the contract signing, whether that be really spec or a builder contract, so we're still in construction, at that point in time, the buyer is really working with the designers and the builder to really make their selections, make their finishes, do their framing walkthrough, any of those kind of different things. So I will say my manager, what I do is I'm really, really involved on the front end. So I'll get the contract. I families, the buyers, the agent, all of that kind of stuff, and kind of know what their wants and needs are so I can share that with the team. But once the contract is signed, I turn them over to the next team, which would be the designers and project managers. And then I would get back involved at the completion. And that really would be what your role would be as well in that regard, because you're welcome to come to the design meetings and everything like that, but that's really, you know, the designer and the buyer at that point in time. Of course, you know, we welcome you to come, but it is just another person and you can move on to a different client at that point in time. So really no need to be there, maybe until the end and do the final walkthrough with them, welcome them to their house, maybe give a client gift if you do that. But in regards of, you know, how involved after contract signing you need to be, I would say maybe 20%. Scott may have a different opinion on that, but there's not much that you need to do after contract signing that we need you for or that the buyer would need you for. It's really more the builder, the designer, the project managers as they go through the different rounds of construction. So I think, Scott, we had a couple questions that came through. Most of them were for you about land and then also the lot if there's a cost for the lot, for the builder to go out and look at the lot and check it. I can speak for Classic Cottages. There is no cost on our end. If you want us to look at a lot, we're happy to do that. We do that all day long. So if there is a lot that you are thinking of or your clients are thinking of to purchase, you can shoot an email to us and we'll happily take a look at it and let you know if we see anything glaring that would be a cause for concern.
Yeah, so we're the same on that particular question as far as will we go out and look at things. We do that a lot. Now, admittedly, we probably wouldn't want to look at 100 different lots for one person since it is kind of a free service we're doing. But if it's someone who's serious and wants to build with us, we're very happy to help them out. And in fact, we'll even create a very, at Focal Point Homes, we'll even create a very detailed site work estimate for them so they can know exactly like what they could be looking at cost as far as to develop that lot versus another. And we're happy to do that. And again, I recommend that you probably have a builder. It's nice to be talking to builders before you buy the lot so that they can raise red flags if that needs to be. And I'm going to swing back up here to a question from Alicia Dooley. And her question is, which of these land characteristics need to be discovered or tested by the buyer versus the builder? For example, soil testing, does the buyer pay for that? Or the builder look into that before building? So what I would recommend is that you get a contingency period of some sort. We are generally getting contingency periods as a builder for maybe 10 days at the most, because we feel like we can find out most everything that we need to find out in that contingency period. The two things that we almost always try to get a contingency period for is one is for testing the soils, because that's just something we can't know very well on our own. That being said, we've built nearly a couple hundred homes in this area, and so we have a lot better feel for soils. And so we don't need contingencies all the time, because we say, oh, we just built a house, a couple doors down, or we built one here, and we know exactly what these soils are like, and so we may not need that. But generally, as far as a contingency goes, the county will require soils testing on almost all lots. And so you will be getting that, but you might need a slight contingency period for that. And then is the, how much is the buyer doing versus the builder? In our case, we would recommend the buyer just talk to us, and we can call a soils engineer, we can call a civil engineer, we can call an arborist for them. Some of that doesn't cost anything to get some input. And then at some point, you have to start paying people, and if they're physically going out to the property and so on. But again, I think it's wise to have a builder involved up front, and just because they probably know a little bit more about what things to watch out for.
Great. One of the other questions on here was, I know you guys are both really amazing builders, but there are others. Is there a good resource to research various builders in an area you're looking to build, or what's the best way to maybe talk to a couple?
Scott, you want to take that one?
Yeah, I was waiting for Michelle to answer. I think certainly you're going to want to have a builder that you can have confidence in that is going to do a good job. And I think now every builder is going to tell you that they're great. But, the best way to probably know that is to talk to other people who have built with them. There may be some reviews online. There's generally not a lot of that online. For us, we've had probably, 65 or 70 customers, fill out Google reviews about us. So I think that's helpful to people. But I think that, generally, if you know someone who's built with someone, or if you're talking to, a lot of real estate agents know, have had experience working with different builders and have a good sense of how things went. And, if they said it was going to take 10 months from contract to completion, does it really take 10 months or it doesn't? And so that would be maybe the best way. I don't know, but maybe some other ways, Michelle, that folks could look for builders.
Yeah, no, I would agree with you, Scott. I think that referrals and getting a referral is the best. That's a very large portion of our business, and our clients are referrals from past home buyers of ours. So I definitely would recommend that. I would also recommend reaching out to the builder and asking for referrals. So, we're happy to provide them. We're happy to talk to you about them. I think that's this day and age, that's probably the best way to go about it.
Yeah, and I would add to that. So Focal Point is a little bit different in that regard, in that we actually will not let people, we will not give people names of people to call. The reason we do that is we just feel like if our clients, you know, once we've built a house for them, we don't want them to feel like they have to be the marketing arm of our company. And it's hard because people want to talk to people all the time. But we just try to protect our clients' privacy. And so we will, although we've had, at least a third of our clients have actually posted very lengthy Google reviews about us. And people can go see that. And you can see the person's name there in those as well. But some builders, or at least we as a builder, would not actually give people phone numbers and or email addresses to reach out to past customers because they'd be getting hundreds of calls, and we kind of want to protect their privacy. But I do agree that it's very valuable to get that information, and we have people all the time who say to us, "Hey, if you ever want to, you have to talk to anybody about the company and our experience, we'd be happy to do it."
Be happy to do it. Yeah.
We don't. And I also, go ahead.
I also think following the builder on social media is also another great way, because we also post things on there in terms of, reviews and stuff like that. So just following along on social media as well really does get you kind of an inside look at, upcoming projects and stuff like that.
Great. And I see a lot of times in my neighborhood, people post on Nextdoor all the time about builders. So if they have a certain area that they're already in, they may be able to just see reviews from any local listserv.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Well, why don't I take another question here that I see, and this actually happens to be from Alicia. Again, it's kind of similar to something I'd already talked about. So Alicia is asking, what would be the benefits of a buyer taking down the lot, so assigning the lot from the builder to the buyer, versus the builder carrying it all the way through the process? And she further asks, is it because buyers typically have lower interest rates than builders? So I'm going to answer the last question first. And I would say probably generally speaking, buyers probably can get a lower interest rate, slightly lower interest rate than builders. Because the banks can sell those loans, there's a market for those loans. And for commercial loans, often builders hold those in-house. So there might be a slightly lower interest rate, but, it's just during construction anyway, so it's probably not going to make a huge difference one way or the other. The reasons that they might want to do it, though, and I talked a little bit about earlier, is that, one, they might want to buy the lot so that they can donate it. Because if they're going to get, a $65,000 tax benefit for having donated the house, that might be worth it for them, even though there might be some tip. Let me pull back on that. So if they buy the lot themselves to begin with, another benefit to that is that they don't have to pay transaction expenses twice. So if we buy the lot for someone, we're going to pay transaction expenses and to record the mortgage and all these different things. And then when we resell the house to them, they would then have to pay those same transaction fees and taxes again. So there's a little bit more expense with having us buy it and then sell it. But again, for a lot of people, they would want us to hold on to it because it's just easier for them to get a loan at the end, and that instead of having to do the acquisition development loan, or for a variety of reasons, it's just not a good timing for them to do that. Or like I said previously, if they feel like there's a lot of demand for the lot and they want to have a more attractive offer, sometimes they'll use us to help that offer be more attractive.
And there's one question here about abandoned cisterns. Does that create a problem for building?
Anything, I think, and I guess it depends on what that was, what it contains. But generally you can take care of, septic fields and underground oil tanks and, water tanks and those kind of things. It's not too difficult. If obviously you get into a case where you've had an oil spill or some sort of, petroleum spill out of a tank, that does cost more expense and a lot more time, since you have to potentially get the EPA and others involved in that type of thing. But I would say that's probably pretty rare fortunately for most lots.
Great, thank you. And then one of the first questions you both will build, obviously, from what you said, for on already purchased land, correct?
Yes.
All right. And then one of the one of our viewers was asking if there's any sort of a handout. I don't know if there's something you all could put together summarizing certain things that NVAR could send out. I don't know if that's a possibility.
So I think that NVAR's plan is to, that they, at least they told us that they're recording this session and they're going to make it available later for viewing. So that might be a good way to review or invite someone else to take a look at it if they wanted to.
Great. Thank you. You guys both have provided such wonderful information. Do we have any last questions? I think we got to everything on the list here. If there's any last minute questions, please write them in and we'll wrap up. Any last minute thoughts, Michelle or Scott, anything else you would like to share before we wrap up?
You know, I would just say, don't be afraid to work with builders. I think that sometimes, at least myself as an agent in the beginning, I was a little bit afraid and, you know, I didn't know a lot. So I felt scared to jump into, you know, going to a builder and really admitting that I didn't know enough about the topic. So, you know, don't feel afraid. Come to us. We're happy to teach you and guide you through the process and hopefully do many deals with you in the future. So, you know, we're not scary, basically, you know, and we're happy to teach as we go.
Yeah, and only so much can be taught in a, you know, kind of 30-minute, you know, Zoom session here or boom set session. And, you know, so we have a lot of real estate agents who I think really appreciate being able to bring their clients in. They'll say, hey, my clients have questions about the process and want to understand this. Sometimes we'll do that, you know, over calls or in non-COVID times, people would come in and still some now as well, will come in and they'll sit down with us for 30 minutes or an hour and they'll ask their questions and you know, be able to sit one-on-one with us and really talk about those things. And a lot of realtors really enjoy being involved in that because it's kind of a learning exercise for them as well, especially if they haven't done that a lot before.
All right, great. Well, we are going to wrap up the session then now. Thank you both so much. That was really, really wonderful. Thank you to everyone who viewed the presentation today as well. We're so happy you were here. And I just wanted to say also a big thank you to NVAR. The next sessions today are going to begin at 1 o'clock, and they are Next Steps for Leadership. That's volunteering on the local, state, and national level. That's on track one. The NVAR Top Producers Committee presents Secrets of the Top Producers. How do they do it? That'll be on track two. And from noon to one, we encourage you to visit our exhibitor booths on the trade show floor. We have a booth there, so I'd love to have you guys visit. Thank you so much again to everybody for being here.
Thank you, Helen.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.